Yeah, welcome back. Okay, back to the fiqh and sharia classification. the word fiqh is not something that could be easily translated. As I said in the first session, it's the most simple of the questions are the most complex. Anyway, it's not easy to translate the word fiqh. In fact, I view fiqh as a combination of three things. So if we talk about fiqh here, we are talking about actually three different circles. One of them has to do with what we call in English spirituality, which is perhaps the area of tasawwuf, in English, for lack of a better word. Not necessarily. I'm not talking about the Sufi tariqas and the Sufi. I'm talking about the knowledge itself, tasawwuf as a knowledge, as an Islamic knowledge. So this is part of fiqh, that is the human understanding, as I said, the first section of the sharia. Okay. So the sharia is understood in terms of those three circles. And one of them in English would be the word ethics. So basically, if you want, in Arabic would be suluk or akhlaq, even though akhlaq is not exactly ethics, but anyway, khuluq, takhalluq, I don't know. It is for a more explanation, it's the practical rules. Let's put it this way, of Islam. And part of it, it has to do with the law, or qanun. We explained that in the first session, in the modern sense, or the legal system, or the if you wish, that the social collective obligations or something. Now, I think it's fair enough to look at fiqh in terms of these three circles, because otherwise we are not being balanced when we discuss the sharia. When we look at the sharia, the sources of that are actually the Quran and the Sunnah. So sharia, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed, we know about that by looking at the Quran. Okay, read the Quran from al-Fatiha to al-Nas. This is sharia. This is the basis of sharia. And the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that has to do with sharia. We'll explain some more about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his different capacities and all of that. This is also very important. But let's, for a general outlook, let's look at the Quran and Sunnah. So the Quran and Sunnah compose the Sharia. If you look at the Quran and Sunnah, in order to come up with fiqh, which is the human understanding of Quran and Sunnah, then you come up with three different areas here. One of them related to spirituality. One of them related to suluk, to behavior. This is behavior with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is behavior with others. Let's put it this way. So there are things related to my behavior with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in salah, for example, I pray. This is something between me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are certain rules and so on for salah. So I make wudu this way, and we discuss the issue of the hands and this and that. There are things. But the essence of the prayer, which is how to really have concentration in my prayer, how to benefit from my prayer to my behavior. There are different levels of concentration, different levels of fa'ida, different levels of usefulness in approaching the prayers that relates to the field of spirituality, or the field in Arabic would be tasawwuf, more than the field of suluk, of practical rules, because the practical rules are not everything. There is an area of intersection between the behavior with God subhanahu wa ta'ala and the behavior with others, and the interaction with others. When I pray, for example, I pray in a jama'ah, I pray, I stand in a line, and there are rules for that, and the adhan, and the iqama, and all of that. With hajj, there are things with other people. But hajj also has a side between me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, for example, when you wear this white clothes, it reminds you of your shroud. And when you go to the area where you throw the pebbles on that rock, it reminds you of rejecting the evil, the shaitan, and so forth. This is not a practical rule, it's a practical rule and a spiritual side of it. So the fiqh, we often look at fiqh only in terms of practical rules, and we forget the spiritual side of fiqh. Even some scholars call it the fiqh al-akbar, the greater fiqh, the greatest fiqh, which is how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly, how to pray properly. The practical of prayers is to make wudu, to say salah for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in some hadith to go on your knees and to raise your hands. Okay, this is the practical of the dua, of prayers. But the dua has much more than that. So, for example, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah antum muqinuna bil ijaba." So when you make dua, be certain that Allah will answer you. Be certain that He will hear you. Have hope in Him when you make dua, that He will give you something, because He opened that door for you, and so forth. That kind of talk about the dua, or about the prayers and so on, is addressed in Islam by the people who wrote on the tasawwuf, on Sufism in Islam. And I'm aware that the circle here is much wider than the circle of the Sharia. They didn't always refer to the Quran and Sunnah. Sometimes they went to their personal experiences. And that is not what I'm talking about here. I'm talking about that area under fiqh. If I look at the Quran and Sunnah in order to have guidelines on how I fast better, or do dua better, or how I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or fear, or awe, or all of these, or thanking Allah, or having patience with people, or patience with life, or whatever, and remembering the hereafter, all of this is also fiqh. And in fact, it's more important fiqh than the practical rules. The Prophet ﷺ, about the man who converted to Islam, and then he heard the Prophet ﷺ reading Surah Al-Zalzala, the Zalzala to Al-Zalzala, the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. So the man cried. So the companion said, but he is new, we want to teach him fiqh. We will take him to teach him fiqh. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, da'uhu faqad faqih. Leave him, he has enough fiqh. He just embraced La ilaha Muhammad Rasulullah, he prayed, and he cried when he read the Quran about the hereafter. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. Whoever does an atom of good will see it, and whoever does an atom of evil will see it. Him being so emotional about the understanding of an atom of good or atom of evil, is something that made him a faqih in that sense. And therefore, the Prophet ﷺ told him, no, this is a faqih, this is fiqh. Okay. So this is number one area. Number two area has to do with the practical rules. The practical rules, the best word I could find in the English language that does not have a better translation in the Arabic language more than fiqh is the word ethics. Because Sharia is about my personal conduct. This is not, it is wrong to translate Sharia as an Islamic law, by the way. And because law, if you're talking English, okay, so if I, even English is not my first language, but my understanding, my sense of the English language is that law has something to do with authority, has something to do with the system, with an enforcement of that law, with something to do with a crime. And in the Sharia, there is a difference between a sin and a crime. And not every sin is a crime. And in fact, the default in sins that they are not crimes. They are sins, but they are not crimes. They are mistakes, faults. And the sin becomes a crime, and the authorities or the law or the society or whatever, we'll talk about that, intervenes when it becomes like a sin that, you know, involves the death of somebody or something that has to do with basic rights. You know, somebody stole something from somebody and so on, to the extent of that stealing being something significant. But if that stealing is not even significant, it's not a crime. It's just a sin, and so forth. You see, so the bulk of fiqh here is ethics that has to do with behavior with others, has to do with practical rules, and these practical rules do not assume the existence of a state that enforces these practical rules. The practical rules are practical rules for Muslims to practice. They don't assume a state behind it. The state, in the modern sense, in the 20th century sense, is actually something that was added to the understanding of Sharia and fiqh by the Islamic groups and the Islamic political parties and so forth, which is great, but it's not in this context. I'm here standing in the United States. No, that is not. Ethics are not assumed to be applied by the state. In fact, this is foreign to Islam. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, he did not enforce his authority to make people pray or fast or any of this. To give zakah, yes, that is true, towards the end of his time, ﷺ, to give zakah at that time to the authorities, and the authorities distribute them over the poor. But you can give zakah to the poor by yourself. You don't have to give that to the authority. In fact, this is something that is part of history now. I don't know of any Islamic government that takes zakat from people and really goes after people for zakat, you see. Otherwise, the Prophet ﷺ left the society to correct itself and to grow in its own ethics. Even in matters as serious as defecting from an army or, you know, the three soldiers who defected from the army of the Prophet ﷺ. He asked the society to boycott them, I mean, and then their wives to separate from them, and so forth. He did not punish, he didn't put them in prison or take them to take a fine from them. He asked the society to correct them. So it was a social ethic that even with a person who defected from the army at that time and during the battle. You are talking about the Prophet ﷺ, the man who came to him and said that his neighbor is harming him, and so on. So he asked him to take his furniture and everything out to the street and put it there. And then people started to ask him, what happened? He said, my neighbor is harming me. The Prophet asked me to take the furniture out. So they came to his neighbor and told him, why do you harm your neighbor? And so forth. So he apologized, the bad neighbor apologized to the good neighbor. The good neighbor put his furniture back. This is not an authority intervening in people's matters. So basically, the Islamic understanding of fiqh in terms of ethics is something that has to do with the personal conduct within the personal freedom that Allah has given to people. Fiqh, at some point in history, was taken, part of it, was taken into the law but in the history sense was a court sense. So historically, we are talking about courts here, rather than law. The original Islamic sense is the fiqh or the ethics go to the courts if it's something that requires a judge. A dispute between people, they go to the judge, and the judge resolves the dispute. Otherwise, people did their ethics without the courts. The courts were not involved in people's day-to-day stuff as we have in the modern state today. So therefore, people divided their inheritances and had their marriage and divorces and custody arrangements and etc., whatever it is, between themselves. And if there is something that is problematic, they go and stand in front of a qadi or a judge. And the qadi has one madhab, as we talked in the first session about the madhab. That is why the qadi had one madhab. We don't have to stick to one madhab. But the qadi had one madhab or one book to refer to, so that that book is like a law, more or less, fixed. More or less, the Hanafis do this, and the Malikis do that, and the Hanbalis or whatever do that. So they, we stand, so the court at that time, which was a judge, a qadi, who was, by the way, independent from the state at that time, independent from the Khalifa. The Khalifa just appoints Qadi al-Qudha, the judge of judges, on top. And then the judges are appointed based on their scholarship. But they don't report to the state. They don't have anything. The Qadi is a Qadi. He's totally independent. Even the Amir, or the Sultan, or the Khalifa, comes and stands in front of the Qadi. If I have a problem with the Khalifa, I go, take the Khalifa, and we both stand in front of the judge. And the judge judges between us based on that madhab. But this was a small part of people's lives. Courts were, did not, you see, today the life is complex, and this is a very, very small part of Islam here, or of fiqh, or of sharia for that matter, which has to do with public order, the collective obligation, the social order that has to be maintained by an authority. At that time, the executive authority in the Islamic history, the executive authority did not intervene in people's lives and did not send police to make people pray or whatever. This is, you know, you create a society of hypocrites if you do that, of hypocrites. Because this is basically what we see today anyway, when people are really pushed to pray and are flogged to be decent. Once they leave their borders, they are not decent anymore, because they are decent based on the pressure of the law, not based on, and that is not the Islamic way. The Islamic way has to do with ethics. But an important part of ethics is what we could call in English spirituality, or the behavior with God, or the personal conduct on a very, very personal level between me and my Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are areas of intersection here that you could imagine. Between the spiritual rules and the practical rules. You see, which has to do with why. Like, why do I raise my hand? I raise my hand to remember that, you know, Allah from up above will give me something. You see, so there is a wisdom here that is in the area between the rules and the spirit of the rule. Or the why in the spiritual sense of the rule. And that's why we make ruku' and sujood, and we have all of this. There is a wisdom in this in order to give humbleness, to give ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our prayers. Why do we give charity? In order to also feel with the poor. Huwa shahrul muwasaa, as the Prophet said about Ramadan. Shahrul muwasaa, the month of benevolence. Why is it specifically the month of benevolence? When I am hungry and when I give my charity, usually the zakah is paid during Ramadan, as you know, the sunnah goes according to some schools anyway, and so forth. When I give charity and when I feel hunger and all of that, I feel compassion towards others. Compassion is a spiritual concept, but the intersection with the practical concept is that when I give charity, I feel compassion. When I visit a sick person, I'm supposed to be compassionate to that person. Visiting the person is the rule. So you walk and you go and you say the dua, assalamu alaikum, and so forth, and the different adayat that the Prophet ﷺ had given us to say the dua. But the spirit above that is compassion. So I'm giving the dua not just to fill in the blank and, you know, click or tick that I did that, my obligation, in the literal sense. Yes, of course, I have to do that. I have to take that I prayed 5 times, and I fasted Ramadan, and I paid my zakah, and I did this and that. But the spirit behind that is something that has to do with the tasawwuf. There is also an area of intersection between the rules and the authorities. In the Islamic sense, is the courts, by the way. The state that enforces the law and all of that, in my humble views, and I told some of you in my introduction at the beginning that I write sometimes about Sharia and politics, in my humble view that modern state is a bid'ah. It's not Islamic anyway. It is not anything Islamic for the state to intervene in everything that people do. Cannot even take a step or a breath without the state telling you what to do. I think that this is a bid'ah. I don't think that this is an, or doesn't mean that in the political sense I'm an anarchist. No, but doesn't mean that. But the Islamic state or the Islamic authority, as I understand it, is somewhere between the two, between the Hobbesian, Westphalian, kind of Machiavellian kind of state, and the anarchist. It's somewhere between the two. And hopefully, inshallah, with the revolutions, we come up with a state that is better than the previous states that was exported to the Islamic world and is causing a lot of its problems. With the nation and sovereignty, and it's not Islamic. There is no borders in Islam, and don't take me wrong, I'm not calling for a global Islamic state or any of that. But I'm saying that taking the borders and sovereignty and nation that seriously is not Islamic, because all human beings are brothers and sisters in Islam, and nations are not supposed to have those much authority over and sovereignty. Sovereignty is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his ethics, his Sharia. Not sovereignty of somebody just because they have monopoly over means of violence. So that's a different story. We'll talk about this in the Q&A. But I'm saying that in the Islamic sense, there are three areas here. One of them is spirituality, and one of them is ethics, and the third one is courts or the authorities, anyhow. When there is a crime that goes beyond a normal sin or mistake or something that the society could correct into an area where there is a danger of the public order of the society. So when there is a danger on the public order, then the authority intervenes in order to deal with issues of killing and stealing, etc., etc., etc. Okay, so this is how the Quran and Sunnah could be applied in the areas of concern here. Fiqh is two levels, as one of you asked, said I will elaborate on that. One is the theory and one is the applied. So each of these has a theory in it and an applied sense. So the theories are called al-usul, fundamentals. In the Islamic language, we have al-usul wal-furu', fundamentals and branches. So usul or fundamentals, this is the fundamental theory. The fundamental theory have a number of theories under that, not just usul al-fiqh as we know them. There is something that's called usul of fiqh, which is the fundamental theory behind getting or extracting the practical rules from the detailed evidence. العلم بالأحكام الشرعية التفصيلية من الأحكام الشرعية العملية من الأدلة التفصيلية. The extraction of the rules or the practical rules, the definition is like that. The extraction of the practical rules from the detailed evidences. These are evidences. These are called evidences or دليل or أدلة. دليل is somebody who, again, talking about Arabic and the desert, as we talked in the morning. Dalil is somebody who takes you in the desert from one point to another. He's a dalil, he's a murshid, a guide. Okay, so the Quran and Sunnah, as we talked also in the philosophical sense, are guides, because our reason cannot reach every good behavior that is there. and everything that is for the good of humanity. So therefore, we need the Quran and Sunnah. So the Quran and Sunnah are our ta'dilla, our evidences, our guidance, guidances or guides. So the guide will take me to the rule via the theory. So the theory says, okay, start by looking in the Quran, if there is a rule about that, look in the Sunnah, do an analogy. And they have a specific, you know, rules in that science that we could discuss later at some point on how the evidences transform into rules anyway. But usually, regardless of the very complex details that are very specific, it is actually a way of translating the Quran and Sunnah into practical rules. So how to do that, scholars have, you know, the theories that they put in order to try to systemize that. But usually they are not systematic. Scholars don't, they don't go Quran, Sunnah, Ijma', Qiyas, Istihsan, Sahaba, Islam. They don't do that. I mean, when you study the 101 Usul al-Fiqh, they will tell you that, you know, you have to do this and that. They give you a systematic. But none of the imams of today or the past have the usul computerized in their mind like that. It's never like that. They look at the evidences, they look at the reality of things, they look at the people, the circumstances, their essence of, their understanding of the essence of Islam, and so forth, and they judge. So they make a judgment based on that. But they don't go in an algorithmic way or any of this. This is just for the sake of learning. So there is usul al-fiqh, and then there is usul al-hadith. In this case, we are talking about the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. His sayings, the hadith, is an evidence to any saying of the Prophet ﷺ. It's an evidence, but that evidence has to be studied in terms of its historical correctness and in terms of its coherence. What they call in the usul al-hadith or ulum al-hadith, al-matn wa sanad. Al-matn is the chain of narrators, and sanad is the chain of narrators, and al-matn is the content, you see. So any hadith, I might stop at this a little bit in order to see this fundamentals of hadith. Any hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said something, there is a person that who said that person Y had said that person X had said that the Prophet ﷺ had said something. Okay, this is a hadith. That hadith, there is a science, usul al-hadith, tries to understand how to authenticate that. In order for this to apply, it has to be authentic. Authentic is a very general word. There are different levels of authenticity. Now, these levels are put by usuliyin of the hadith, fundamentalists or fundamental theorists of the hadith. So they say that these people have to be trustworthy, and they have to have a good memory, and so forth. They cannot be known to be liars, and all of that. Z must meet Y at some point in his or her life. Y must meet X at some point in his or her life. X has to be a companion in order to claim that the Prophet said. Y cannot say the Prophet said if Y has never seen the Prophet. In fact, they have differences over that. Does Y have authority to say that Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though he never said? What about if Z says? What about if, and so forth? So they have a certain way of correcting what's called a sanad, or the narration, or the narrator's chain, if you wish. Sanad al-isnad is to say that on the authority of this, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar, he said that on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar, Nafi' said that Abdullah ibn Umar said, Malik said that Nafi' said. So Malik said that Nafi' said that Abdullah ibn Umar said that the Prophet said. Malik, Imam Malik, whom we know, is not somebody who saw the Prophet. He saw Nafi'. And Nafi' was a student of the companions, Tabi. So Nafi' said that Abdullah ibn Umar said. Abdullah ibn Umar said that the Prophet ﷺ said something. Okay? And that is how it goes. Now, there is another side that is very important for the narrator, the narrations, which is called al-matn. Al-matn is the content. And now this is very important because oftentimes we have the content without the story. We have the hadith without the story. And this is, if I may say, is one of the major challenges for people who study Sharia. Because there are hadith that contradict, quote unquote, or oppose in the meaning others. And therefore, what you need is the story. We have a hadith that says that the Prophet ﷺ is talking about, was it a Jewish person? Yeah, from the people of the book, he's saying, talking about a Jewish person who saw a dog in the desert, and the dog is very thirsty. So the guy took his shoe and put water in it and gave the dog water, and the dog, and he said, this dog is as thirsty as I am. Allah gave him paradise. Okay, that's one hadith. There's another hadith in which the companion ﷺ, he said, أَمَرَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بِقَتْلِ الْكِلَابِ. The Prophet ﷺ asked us to kill the dogs. And then the rest of the story is not there. Where is the story? Now, if you look at other narrations, you will start to see parts of the story. But the other narrations sometimes are not as strong as the narration that is very precise that Bukhari or Muslim put it. Because Bukhari was very, very particular about item number one, not necessarily item number two, about the authentication of the sanad. So when Bukhari says this is sahih, this is authentic, he's saying it is correct in terms of the narrators, not necessarily in terms of the content. The content could be anything. And this is one of the examples I'm telling you. And therefore, if you go to other ahadith, you will realize that no, there was a story. Actually, a number of dogs attacked the companions in Medina. They were mad dogs that attacked the companions in groups, apparently, and many of them were injured. So the Prophet ﷺ told them, okay, kill those dogs, or kill the dogs. And in fact, there is another narration in Muslim, when the Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَوْلَا أَنَّ الْكِلَابَ أُمَّةٌ مِنَ الْأُمَمِ لَأَمَرْتُ بِقَتْلِهَا. Had dog not been a nation amongst the nations, I would have allowed you to kill them. But no, do not kill them. So when they killed too many of them, the Prophet said, no, this is not my point. The point is to kill the mad dogs who were attacking the people. It is not about killing dogs as they are, because dogs are a nation amongst the nation. He's borrowing the Quranic expression. There is a verse that says, Surah Yunus. Anyway, in the verse in the Quran is saying that there is no single bird or animal that is walking or flying except as nations, as you are. They are nations. So you put all of this together, now you can start to see the content. So the content goes hand in hand with the narrators, with the narrator's chain in the sciences of the Sharia. And therefore, it is very important to have usul al-hadith, the fundamentals of hadith. How can we validate a hadith in terms of the chain of narrators and in terms of the content? And people who wrote about usul al-hadith had talked about the content. They said, for example, that the content cannot go against the correct Arabic language. So even if the chain of narrators is authentic and these guys are trustworthy and their memory is good and they all met each other consecutively, but they are narrating something, the Arabic of which is not proper. This is not the Arabic of the Prophet. I came across some of these. This is not how Muhammad spoke. His Arabic is so high. You can distinguish, of course, the Quranic Arabic is very different. But then the Muhammadan Arabic is lower than the Quranic Arabic. But it's not like, you know, some of the narrators are saying. And therefore, obviously, they either reworded it or they made a mistake, and therefore you cannot really rely on that. So scholars stop in front of that and say, no, this is not correct. They say, for example, matn cannot contradict reason. And that is very interesting, because Ibn Salah, for example, he's saying in his Muqaddimah that the hadith cannot contradict al-aql, the reason. We talked about reason in the first session. And how do you define that? And so forth. It opens a lot of questions about whether the hadith could contradict the reason. So I'm not talking about Muhammad contradicting Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I'm talking about the narrators. They might make mistakes in understanding exactly what Muhammad is saying, and therefore what they convey to us is something that the scholars of hadith have to look at before the hadith becomes fiqh. Because sometimes fiqh is done without looking at that particular consideration, and there is a lot of error here. Another consideration is the contradiction consideration. So for example, this Ibn Rushd, for example, otherwise Ibn Rushd in his Bidayat al-Mujtahid, he commented on the dog's hadith. He said, how come the Prophet ﷺ is asking us to feed the dogs and quench their thirst on one hadith, and in the other hadith he's asking us to kill them? He said, no, killing the dogs is not an Islamic requirement or recommendation by any chance, and perhaps the hadith has some context, and he left it there. So he, as a mujtahid, was able to reject some of the narrations that did not make sense to the bigger picture that he can see. That the bigger picture, Islam is good to animals. Islam is not about killing anything, let alone go and extinct the dogs from the face of this earth. There are so many hadith that are contradictory in that sense. We mentioned in the morning the contradiction between the different positions of the hand and leaning on the ground and the different ways of saying adhan and takbirs for Eid and tashahud and salam and the janazah. And you name it. Actually, most of the practices that we practice have different opinions. And in this case, you have to, what they call, reconcile the matn. There is one hadith in which the Prophet raised his hand, and another hadith in which the Prophet did not raise his hand, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So to reconcile, for example, some of the Ahnaf said, well, he raised his hands when it was a bigger crowd, maybe somebody would not hear him. So he would raise his hands for them, if they can't hear him, to see his hands. But when he was by himself praying, he didn't raise his hand. For example, one way of rationalizing about how to conciliate the matn that is different, the content that is different, and that is very important. Other people went into the abrogation business and say, okay, well, we just look at the dates and history, and whatever is lost is it, and we cancel everything else. And that is also, that cannot be applied to everything, because that is also erroneous in some ways. I can explain some of that. I'm personally, in terms of usul, I'm totally against the abrogation theory, but I can get into some of that later on anyway. And so forth. So some people cancel some of the narrations based on the apparent contradiction. Some people decided to reconcile. Imam Shafi'i, for example, in his Risala, when he talked about at-tashahud, so at-tahiyyatu lillah, salawatu al-tayyibat, there are so many narrations, 7 or 8 of them. He narrated them all, and they are all at his authority, and he knows the chains, and he authenticated all of them. And then he said, I can't reconcile all of this except with the fact that this is all about praising Allah. He said, وَمَا فِي التَّشَهُدِ إِلَّا تَعْظِيمَ اللَّهِ وَهَكَذَا تُجْمَعَ الْرِوَيَاتِ. So the only way I can reconcile all of this is that all of them are about glorifying Allah. This is not Quran. التحيات is not Quran. You can, you know, drop a word or less or more, and this is also التحيات anyway. According to Shafi'i, you can say التحيات لله, السلام عليك أيها النبي, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله, اللهم صل على محمد. So for example, so some people, some from the scholars tried to reconcile the differences in order to reach the essence of the narrations. Because sometimes the differences, one narration allows something and another narration does not allow it. how can you reconcile? You know, by looking at the deeper meaning, by looking at the higher meaning, right? And then you can start to reconcile. When we get to the details, we'll discuss much more examples, inshallah. And also new comments and questions, please, feel free. So basically, in the usul of hadith, people discuss two things, the narrators and the content, and how the narrators could be validated or authenticated or evaluated as people. And we have an Islamic science that is unique in the human civilizations, which is ilmu rijal, the science of men. Or the science of rijal in Arabic means men and women, by the way. Rijal la tuhi in tijaratun arabay. Rajul in Arabic is a man or a woman, is a human being. So ilmu rijal includes the men and women who narrated anything about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in any of the different levels. So you see lots of people, I don't know how many, hundreds of thousands, perhaps, of people who narrated anything about the Prophet ﷺ in any layer of the layers of history. And they evaluated these people. And they differed over some, and they agreed over some. They agreed over most of the companions, or let's say all the companions. Some scholars have different opinions about who's a companion anyway. Ibn Hazm, for example, and others. They said the companion, the usual definition is that the companion is somebody who saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But then the Ahnaf and some other imams like Ibn Hazm and others, they differentiate between the companion who is a faqih and a companion who is not faqih. Companion who is knowledgeable and the companion who is not knowledgeable. Because not every guy who was standing there at the end of the last ceremony, the last ceremony of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was 100,000 people standing there. And then he died soon afterwards, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And those 100,000, most of them saw the Prophet for the first and last time in that speech. So yes, some of them narrate things, but is this as authentic as Abu Bakr or Umar or Aisha? No, that is different. Because, and therefore here, when there is a contradiction between something that Aisha narrates and something that others narrate, usually scholars stand with Aisha, some don't. Usually, some don't, and for obvious reasons, male female reasons, but most scholars stand with Aisha in her stance. For example, the hadith of Abu Huraira, the one of the great companions too, but he was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam much less number of years and much less contact than Aisha. Aisha corrected a number of narrations given by Abu Huraira. One of them is hadith al-tira, the hadith of bad omens, in which Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu said, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم الطيرة في المرأة والدابة والدار. Bad omens are in your woman, in your mount or animal, and in your house. So there are bad omens in these three things. You have to be pessimistic with your house, with your animal or mount, or with your wife. Or al-mar'a in general, woman in general. Aisha, people went to her and told her, إِنَّ أَبَا هُرَيْرَةَ يُحَدِّثُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم كان أقول. Abu Huraira is telling us that the Prophet said that bad omens are in women and animals and houses. What is that? So she said, وَاللَّهِ مَا كَانَ الْحَدِيثُ عَلَى هَذَا. Wallahi, this has never, she gave an oath that this was never the hadith. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had said, كان أهل الجاهلية يقولون الطيرة في المرأة والدابة والدار. He said the people before Islam, the people of the days of ignorance, which is the people before Islam, Jahiliyyah, days of ignorance, before Islam, pre-Islam, people before Islam used to say that bad omens are in women, houses, and mounts. And then in another narration, she's continuing, فدخل أبو هريرة فسمع آخر الحديث ولم يسمع أوله. He entered in the middle of the talk. He heard the last part of it, and he did not hear the first part. The first part, the Prophet ﷺ was saying that the people at the days of ignorance were saying so and so and so and so. And then he went, وَالطِّيَرَةُ فِي الْمَرْأَةِ وَالدَّابَةِ وَالدَّارِ. So that is what Abu Huraira zoned in. Does this mean that Abu Huraira is weak or something? Of course not. In terms of narration, he's a great imam, and he gave us many, many important narrations. But it means that sometimes the companions or the narrators afterwards make errors in the narration of the hadith. And this is normal, this is human. Sometimes we raise the companions to the level of prophets, and they are not. The Prophet ﷺ was infallible. He does not make mistakes in the moral sense, of course. He made mistakes in the technical sense, of course, and I will talk about that too. But in the moral sense, Prophet ﷺ was above the mistakes of morality. Adultery and stealing and killing, and no, of course not. Muhammad was higher than that. Every prophet was higher than that. We don't believe in the prophet's sins that are in the Bible and so on. So the prophets are higher than that, right? But other than that, the companions made mistakes and made misjudgments. And therefore, if there is a content, a matn, that is funny, that is, you know, what is this, bad omens are in women and so on. And similar, and especially in the hadith related to women, it's not about women in Islam here, so I don't want to get into that a lot. But no, many, many of the hadith that are related to women, and I had some interest in that at some point, did research. I found many scholars contradicting with these hadith based on other hadith that raise the status of women and all of that, etc. And they said that there is a problem with the content here. There is something, there is a story that the companion did not get or did not narrate, and so forth. And sometimes the commentators side with one interpretation over the other because they have a, I don't know, too much to throw, but a male view of the world. You see, so for example, Ibn al-Arabi al-Maliki, the Imam of the Malikiyah, Ibn al-Arabi is a Sufi guy with a, you know, the, but I'm talking about Ibn al-Arabi. When he commented on the Hadith al-Tayra, for example, to give you one example, he commented on Aisha's saying that Abu Huraira did not hear that all, everything, and actually this is something that was pre-Islamic. Islam does not any have any bad omens. He said, قَوْلُهَا قَوْلٌ صَاقٍ. What she is saying is nonsense, he said. وَكَيْفَ تَرُدُّ حَدِيثًا صَحِيحًا رِوَاتُهُ ثِقَاتٍ. How can she reject an authentic hadith with authentic narrators? First of all, at the time of Aisha, we didn't have these chains and narrators and riwayat, and like he's talking about himself, really. It was Aisha and Abu Huraira and the Prophet saying something, and actually both of them are narrations. Aisha's narration is a narration too, and she is a narrator too, and she is a muhaddith too. Like, come on, like Aisha, she's Prophet's wife, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the closest to him, and so forth. Many, many things. I could talk about Aisha for an hour, and. So for him to say that the mother of the believers is saying nonsense because she rejected a narration, that rejects that bad omens are in women and that they are source of bad omens, this shows you a little bit of what I am saying, that sometimes fiqh, that is human, we talked about it in the first section, how fiqh is human, sharia is divine, sharia is not discriminatory, sharia is about justice, and about mercy, and about common good, and sharia is about every idea that you think about. But fiqh, to translate that into a human understanding, sometimes that goes right and sometimes it goes wrong. So the fiqh of Ibn al-Arabi, and he was a great imam too, by the way, and read his books, but in that particular thing, his understanding went wrong. Because he thought that bad omens are really in women and houses and all that from his own whims, really, because there are other narrations, maybe he's aware of them or maybe not, that la tayarata fil Islam, there are other narrations, authentic too, not in Bukhari and Muslim, but also authentic, that there is no bad omens in Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ only believed in good omens. So somebody says something that is, we call it in the modern language, in synchronous, like synchronicity and all of that. So somebody is saying, ya najah or ya nujayh, or somebody is calling somebody and the other guy's name is Success. All success come here, he said, Atakum al-Najah. Success had come. So he took good omens, he took good optimistic signs from, in a joking manner, or let's say, I don't know, half joking manner, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, based on good things that happened. Somebody's name is Success, somebody's name is this. And in fact, he asked people with bad names to change their names because it's a bad omen. It's not a good name. He changed one of the companions. His name was Harb, war. He told him, no, that's not a good name. Change your name. You see, Islam is not about war, really. So because the name Harb, even though the Prophet of course fought many battles and everything, and this is politics. That's a different story. It's very important, and for the sake of justice and everything. But the name war is not silly. So he, what I'm trying to say is that the general picture, the big picture, is very important in understanding what Islam is about. And when the scholars approach these sensitive issues, they have to have the big picture in mind. And the big picture is very important. I'll talk about it next. And the other thing I want to say is that this is really for the scholars rather than amateurs like us. I think that we need to look at this with appreciation to the great depth of knowledge that the scholars of hadith had in order to narrate all of this. So in order for a scholar to reject a hadith, that is a big deal. That if you are a student of knowledge, you need to really, really think 20 times before you do that. Because to say that, no, this hadith is not authentic, of course you have to look at what scholars said and look at the history. And as I said, the madhab is our history anyway. So we look at the history and so forth, and we try to understand. But then before you make a judgment like that, that authentic narrators are telling you that the Prophet said something, before you reject that, you need to be very careful. But you have to be open to this possibility, because it is true. And there are some landmines that we have in the Islamic thought that we have to deal with courageously today, talking about Islam being a source now of legislation in a modern state sense, and these things that are said, instead of just being narrators, they're going to be laws and constitutions. No, that's a very serious story. We have to really look at what is narrated, and we have to be allow ourselves to be critical, because this is people's life and families and stuff and punishment for crimes and things we will define as crimes and big deals. So we have to really be careful, and it is about time to be critical, because now we are taking the Sharia in terms of fiqh to become law in the modern sense in the Muslim majority countries anyway, and that is a very sensitive issue to deal with. Yes,
some people would say that if we open the door for rejecting the hadith by whether the method makes sense or not, then basically we are, you know, destroying the whole credibility of the chain of narrators and the whole credibility of the hadith sahih narrated in Bukhari and Muslim, because this is the very reason why we accept these hadith, is because they were authenticated in terms of sanad. So if you're saying that it doesn't make sense, so you can reject it, so it means that one of these guys in the narration, that everyone accepted them as authentic narrators, is either lying or is not authentic as we think. So what protects the whole history, the whole Bukhari and Muslim and all the...
Well, I think we have to allow ourselves to grow from the binary way of thinking into a more sophisticated way of thinking. And I don't think we can approach Islam in the modern sense, in the contemporary sense, seriously without a sophisticated way of approaching Islam. So therefore, how come Abu Huraira narrated something that is supposed to be weak, then Abu Huraira is all like rejected? No, that is very simplistic. No, nobody said that. How come Ibn al-Arabi is saying something impolite against Aisha, therefore Ibn al-Arabi and the whole Maliki madhab is batil, you know? No, I think that we need to evolve with the evolution of logic. Logic of the contemporary times, logic of the 20th century especially its second half, is a logic that is moving from binary classifications of issues to gray levels between black and white in every classification. And therefore, there are levels of authenticity and levels of credibility and levels of truth and so forth. And we cannot really say that we are afraid the masses will reject the companions just because Abu Huraira made a mistake in one or seven or 10 hadiths out of 30,000 that he narrated, and therefore we reject him or reject the Sunnah altogether. Some people say based on that, okay, then the Sunnah, why do we have Sunnah? We have the Quran, and then eventually we reject the Quran, and eventually we reject God.
And a lot of people have already started doing that.
People, okay, but in order to counter that, the right thing here, in addition to being right scholarship, is not to say no, the companions are infallible, and you guys are kuffar. And no, that is not the right way. The right way is to look at these claims of people who want to reject the Sunnah and say, okay, what are you rejecting exactly, and what, how? You're rejecting the way we pray or fast? We cannot pray or fast from the Quran only. The details are not there. We have to take the Sunnah, for example. And therefore, what do you reject? Well, we reject human rights problems in Islam. Okay, what do you mean by that? Okay, one, discrimination against women. Okay, in what sense? And for what? Okay, then this hadith. Okay, well, no, this hadith is weak. The other hadith. No, the other hadith is strong. This is how Islam is. It's different. For example, so what I'm saying is, I know it will get complex, but it is very important to get a bit sophisticated when we approach Islam. The other thing is the level and the background of people you are speaking with, for example. If you're speaking in some parts of the Arabic world, of the Arab world, to people who are mostly illiterate, they don't know anything, really. Their knowledge could be complex in the business sense, or whatever they buy and sell, but they are not complex enough to understand. So you don't give a khutbah if you go to Egypt or wherever. Don't stand in the Egyptian countryside and give a khutbah on how Abu Huraira made some mistakes. I think that is very wrong, because that is not fiqh. The fiqh is to give people what they can understand. I understand here from the introductions, except for people who came late, that you don't have a technical background in the Sharia, I understand. But you have a level of education that allows you to understand that I'm not rejecting the Sunnah, I'm not rejecting Abu Huraira, or rejecting any of this. I'm just saying that we need to understand the complexity of issues. So I'm saying this in a course where people have a level of education that allows them to understand. If you have a background in the Sharia and so forth, which some of my students have when I teach back in Doha, when I teach to a Sharia course to Sharia students in the fiqh department, I speak a different language from that. I even get to the problems that we have with ilm al-hadith and with ilm al-usul, and the problems with the logic that and the Greek logic, really, what I call it, the Greek logic that the usul was built on, and a long story that is technical, that you might not have the background to see. So there are different levels and different ways of approaching. It is true, and especially when I get now to the big picture and the maqasid and all of that, it is true that some people will abuse that kind of knowledge. But well, this is the nature of Islam anyway. You know, people abuse its knowledge all along. But the truth remains the truth. And the ummah of Muslims has a consciousness that is very mature. And people who doubted that fact are learning it now in the past couple of years with the political changes. The collective consciousness of Muslims is very mature, despite the fact that they are hungry and thirsty and uneducated and ill and all of that. But their collective understanding, so inshallah, eventually, that kind of understanding will become widespread knowledge, hopefully. When we talk about something, Islam, as anti-women or anti-dog or anti-environment or anti-something or anti-rights or anti-rule of law or anti of this that people talk about, and then we have to reject one of the narrations or one of the opinions, for that matter, of one of the imams, great imams of the past, but his opinion on this is actually wrong. In order to allow ourselves to do that, then perhaps inshallah the public consciousness will start to change and understand the complexity of these issues. That yes, Imam Shafi'i was a great imam, but yeah, he did some mistakes in his opinions. And Imam Bukhari was a great imam, and and his book is an authentic book, but there are some ahadith there that are weak. As simple as that. I mean, it doesn't make the whole 3,500 best collections that we have, hadith of Bukhari, it doesn't make all of them bad, but yes, some of them are not authentic. And scholars know that.
It makes you just not sure what to take and what to believe.
Ask the people of knowledge. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Because, I mean, yeah, if you are not sure. And it's also, there is also something that could be useful perhaps for you, which is when you're not sure, perhaps you should be cautious. They call it in fiqh, in this area, not in this area, they call it al-wara'a. Al-wara'a is cautiousness. Is something that I'm not sure about, and really, I'm not sure if it is sunset yet, or I'm not sure if this is fajr. Okay, I will stop now, even though I don't know if it's fajr yet, because I don't want to be well into fajr. I could be well into fajr, you know, fiqh. Even in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, the companion, the fajr came and he was drinking something. The Prophet told him, continue your meal. So yes, in the fiqh, it is not exactly by the minutes and seconds. You can finish your meal and then continue within a reasonable time. But that is fiqh without wara', you know. So, and with wara' is to really try to keep a distance, a safe distance. But fiqh proper, no, is very, very flexible. Islam is incredibly more flexible than we think. But we really need to keep a distance, because sometimes the area between right and wrong is a dangerous area. You find yourself doing everything that is wrong in the book based on an opinion of somebody who told you that, oh, this amount of alcohol is fine, or this amount of this, and then you extend yourself and find yourself doing everything in the book. And that is haram. And you find yourself a very immoral person in the name of Islam too. No. So we have to keep a distance. So al-wara' is one aspect of al-fiqh, I might write it here if you wish, that is very important when we deal with fiqh, which is caution, really. Try to be cautious. And that is something between you and your Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Under extreme conditions, you could need cautiousness less. And under conditions of, inshallah, and health and wealth and so on, you will need caution, because you're fine, you're good, you're not under a darura or under extreme condition, you're not lost in a desert, and so forth. But if you are, right in the Quran, فَمَنْ اِطْطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about pork and all that. And he said, if somebody is in necessity, in اِطْطُرَّ, in فَرَاءٍ, or darura, or necessity, darar, we talked about the roots of the language in the beginning. So darura has something to do with darar, with harm. When there is harm, then you can break your fast, you can do things, there is harm. And the harm, the darar has to do with darura. The harm has something to do with necessity. So when we talk about darura, we are talking about darar. We are talking about something that will harm me. And therefore, I could have less caution, because I'm gonna die here, I'm gonna lose an arm, I'm gonna, you know, something, you know, lose something, or lose an important support, or whatever it is. And then it becomes the cautiousness here, or caution, becomes less important. Yeah.
I like this layout, and it makes more sense to me now that I look at it. I would love to believe it. I do. I just have one issue, and maybe it's just I'm not trying to be the devil's advocate or like
sure.
Offensive or anything. You said like not all the sins are crimes, which makes sense. Like maybe kadhib is not a crime, it doesn't hurt anybody else. Lying, well, it could it depends on the severity of it. But like for instance, adultery. To me, that falls in the ethics, in the suluk, akhlaq, especially if the both parties are not married or anything. They don't want to hurt anybody. Maybe by example, they might hurt a nation or something. So how is it judged in the ethics part and not in the court?
I knew it was coming, the question of hudud, but I mean... Okay, sure.
It's a good question, right?
Yeah, it is a very important question. Yeah, I know. Okay, sure. All the tough questions will come. But sure. First of all, adultery, as it is not by any measure a crime. It's a sin. It becomes a crime under certain conditions. That's if we go in the classic fiqh. We are not doing any ijtihad here, or we're not looking at any darura or anything. We're not doing, we're going classic fiqh in every school of law and every scholar. Adultery per se was not a crime that is punishable by authorities unless there are a certain number of conditions that are supported. Like, so for example, adultery for the particular example has to be seen by four people, all of them have coherent witnessing, and so forth. Now, that makes it not adultery per se, it is public adultery. It's adultery in the public space, where people can see it, and four, not just one or two or three. They are actually lashed, and their witnessing in court will never be accepted forever if they claim that they saw adultery and there are three people. Okay, they have to be four. That's the Sharia proper. And it cannot be proven by CCTV or whatever. No, this is not Sharia. The Sharia is four people, because this is the Quran was very specific about that. It's not like you don't take circumstantial evidence for that. This is something that is particular. In the classic sense, I'm still talking the classic sense. So in the classic sense, the things move from this area to this area when they harm what is called the public order. So if adultery in a society that applies that had anyway, which in any case, in a society that applies that punishment, if it becomes a public order problem, stealing, for example, for another, if it doesn't become a crime that is punishable by law, unless the stealing is above what's called an nisab, you know, a certain amount that makes the stealing significant, not somebody who stole $10 from some till or shoplifted something. This is not really the definition of sariqa in that sense. It doesn't. So it has to be a crime that and killing is not by mistake or whatever. It has to be killing with intention, and for this to be punishable by law in that sense. Okay. So not every sin is a crime. This is ABC Sharia. But when it becomes crime, it's based on number of conditions. Now, the punishment itself is something that is the job of the state. And the state could use these punishments and could not use these punishments. Now, this is something that is subject to debate. I would not give you my opinions from the Sharia perspective, but I would give you what's happening in the Muslim majority countries today. Like, who are the countries that apply these punishments, the particular punishments? I'm not talking about the crime. The crime, we agreed, it's a crime against the public order and so forth. But who applies these punishments anyway? It applied for a couple of years during Numeri of Sudan at that time. He actually, mashallah, he wanted to cut the hands and cut the throats of all of his opposition, and that's what he did. And that's a fact. He misused or used or whatever it is that in order to, okay. And in Nigeria for some time, and Afghanistan under Taliban, and in the Arabian Peninsula these days, but really in a very similar way, selectively, based on whom you're talking about, under certain circumstances. Of course, the law is saying that it has to be with the provision of the king or the emir or the sultan or whatever it is, and they usually don't allow that to happen, even if the judge gives the punishment as a punishment. And none of the other major Arab countries or Islamic countries really seriously think about it. Scholars silently are not including it in the law. And the scholars, the mainstream, of course, there are views, and here and there, and the public view, of course, about the Sharia is only this, which is really. And some scholars take a new look, like, for example, the scholars of Egypt during the codification period, Sanhuri, and then eventually talked about the criminal law, Shawi and Al-Awwa, and these people who wrote about that and were in the committees. They said that there is a provision that is called Tawbat al-Jani, you know, the repentance of the criminal. So if the criminal comes to court and says that he or she repented, then the had doesn't even apply to them. And they cited very strong opinions. I wrote probably about that in one of my books, and so forth. So if you, and others who are saying that the general conditions are not applied because of the general injustices in the societies, and therefore calling for a moratorium or whatever, like Akhi Tariq and others. So I would say that the debate over the hudud is a political debate rather than anything else, anything real about the Sharia, because people who have the Sharia in their constitution as a source of legislation, they don't apply that, and they don't seriously think about applying it. I know personally a number of people in the Sharia committees in the Egyptian parliament. Nobody seriously think of applying that. So I think for people who are living in other countries, in non-majority countries like here, I don't think that this part should be part of our definition of Sharia. Our definition of Sharia, by all practical means here, is the circle of ethics and spirituality, not the circle of courts. The courts is the law of the land. Like really, in this particular case, let's say in America. In America, we're not really talking about Islamic courts in any serious sense, because this requires a consensus in the society. That's according to the Sharia. The Sharia is not to Allah. So we pray, inshallah. So the point is that I think this would be the window we are talking about, and not this window. This window would be the law of the land, as simple as that. And inshallah, continue after that.
Just
as we
come back at 2.
2 o'clock is good. So we start at 2, inshallah. Quick plan. Thank you.